Welcome, everyone. First to today's top story, three American military personnel have died in a crash off the coast of the Northern Territory.
The aircraft took off from the RAAF base in Darwin for what was supposed to be a routine military exercise. 23 people were on board and five are now in hospital in a serious condition.
Today, reporter Andrea Crothers is in Darwin. Andrea, a major investigation is underway.
Yeah, good morning, guys. It certainly is to determine exactly what caused that crash. Overnight, we saw a statement from Australia's Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese, sending his deepest condolences as well as promising to provide whatever support is needed for as long as it's needed. Now, we know typically as these investigations get underway, this fleet will be grounded. The exercise they were taking part in, Predators Run, a joint exercise with the Philippines, Timor-Leste, as well as Australia and Indonesia, that has been halted until further notice. This Osprey, it was over Melville Island, 60 kilometres north of Darwin. It's the largest of the Tiwi Islands, when it went down, triggering a major emergency response. As you said, 23 on board, three now confirmed dead, 20 others injured, including five seriously so. A code brown was declared here at the Royal Darwin Hospital to make way for those victims as they continued to come in throughout the afternoon and evening. Now, no Australians were involved in this crash, but this certainly has put the troubled history of these Ospreys back in the spotlight. There have been two fatal crashes in the last year alone. One in California that was put down to mechanical issues involving a club. Another fatal crash in Norway during NATO exercises. So, guys, just a real tragedy.
Yeah. Thank you.
To breaking news now out of Sydney, a man has been rushed to hospital in a serious condition after being stabbed in Sydney's northern beaches. Today, Sydney reporter Gabrielle Boyle is on the scene in Manly. Gabby, good morning to you. What more do we know?
Brooke, good morning to you. I'm joining you from Melvin Avenue in Manly. We're just one street back from the beach. This is a busy residential area with high-rise apartments and plenty of family homes. And this morning it is a major crime scene with many uniformed police, plainclothes detectives speaking with witnesses outside of this apartment complex after a man in his 20s was stabbed repeatedly last night. Police and paramedics were called to the scene about 2:30 a.m. with reports that this man in his 20s had been stabbed in the arm, shoulder and chest. He's been taken to Royal North Shore Hospital to be treated for some very serious injuries. And this morning, this area remains a crime scene as police piece together exactly what took place in the early hours of the morning.
Okay, thanks, Gabby. A report is this morning being prepared for the coroner after a fatal crash in Melbourne's northeast. Five people were inside a ute when it rolled and crashed in limestone, killing one of those inside. The two others were airlifted to hospital, one man with life-threatening injuries. An alleged drunk driver has caused chaos in Sydney's northwest overnight, crashing into multiple parked cars in Schofields. Police were called to Alex Avenue at about 10 o'clock, finding the man still inside his vehicle. He returned a positive roadside breath test and was taken to hospital for further testing. Police are this morning investigating whether street racing was a factor in a crash in Sydney's south, which killed two boys aged just 9 and 10.
I think any parent would be quite shaken, you know, to learn that news, and yeah, it's horrible what's happened.
Death drivers, as I call them now, not the hoons, they're death drivers. This is the third accident within the week.
Investigators are looking for the driver of a grey sedan captured driving past the crash site at Monterey. 33-year-old Jimmy Brito is accused of dangerous driving offences, due to face court on September 7. Jetting off on a European holiday, Queensland Premier Anastasia Palaszczuk is leaving concerns over her leadership in the hands of her colleagues. Acting Premier Stephen Miles hosing down speculation he's gunning for the top job.
I understand there'll always be chatter, there'll always be rumours and gossip. I hope you'll think I make a good Deputy Premier. I work hard at that job, I love that job, and I'd like to keep doing it. Our leader, Anastasia Palaszczuk, will and can lead us to the next election.
The internal unrest comes after a chaotic week in Parliament after controversial amendments to youth crime laws.
Well, after 6 months and 24 rounds of some of the most gripping games of AFL, the final eight teams have been locked in. Isabella Stashkovsky is at the MCG this morning and joins us live now. Is there an exciting few weeks ahead?
Sarah, good morning to you. That's certainly right. GWS actually just snuck into the top eight last night following a win against fellow finalists in Carlton. And I want to show you this fixture because, of course, the other teams have already been locked and loaded, but there is certainly a lot of love for Victoria despite two sides coming from New South Wales. All but one game will be played here in Melbourne. And I do have some fresh and quite exciting news for footy fans this morning, and it is all about that AFL Grand Final parade. Well, the river aspect, it is going to get the boot. I can tell you that the AFL is expected to announce that it is all back to tradition, back to the Hiluxes. We do have a map of what it is all expected to look like, actually starting around near Rollover Arena, and then that parade will make its way here to the MCG with a live site as well for fans. There is expected to be more detail also around that footy festival at Yarra Park in the coming days. But Sarah, some very welcome news, I think, for everyone who was just saying that that parade on the river was an absolute flop. So see you never.
Order has been restored.
See you never.
Thanks, Issa.
The man in charge of running South Australia's Hindmarsh Stadium has been stood down over an attempt to ban Melbourne Victory fans following concerns over fans storming the pitch. The Board of Adelaide Venue Management, which operates the stadium on behalf of the government, is putting CEO Anthony Kirchner under review. He's believed to have authorised the ban. Two Australians remain in hospital after falling 10 metres from a wall in the coastal city of Dubrovnik in Croatia. A 26-year-old woman is fighting for life while a 34-year-old man has undergone surgery and remains in a critical condition. The pair were heavily intoxicated. The coalition government is calling on Labor to urgently pull together a national convicted terrorist offender register to keep Australians safe. Between October and mid-next year, eight convicted terrorists are set to be released into the community, with the opposition saying it would have long-term obligations on convicted terrorists. The government says any changes will be based on appropriate advice. Russian authorities have officially confirmed the death of the Wagner mercenary chief, Yevgeny Prigozhin. Overnight, investigators revealed that genetic testing showed that the victims of a plane crash last week matched all of the names on the jet's manifest. Prigozhin was among the 10 people killed in a plane crash northwest of Moscow. The gunman who carried out a racially motivated shooting at a discount store in Jacksonville, Florida, has this morning been identified. 21-year-old Ryan Palmita is seen in this security video entering the store armed with an AR-15, killing three people.
There's three people who lost their lives. That's not a game. That's the reality of what we're dealing with. Please let us stop viewing each other as pieces on a game board, and let us please start to see each other's humanity.
Jacksonville police have confirmed the rifle and handgun had been purchased legally.